Hey everybody, Jazzy here. Welcome to the final part of the Wanda Boss Run. I'm gonna throw all of the remaining bosses into this episode, so it will be a bit longer. I'm also gonna throw in some timestamps so that you can navigate around. You will, however, miss a rare Jazzy death, and as always, the precious golden Jazzy moments of sound survival advice. But you're a busy person, and I am here to serve. So let's get started. Last time we cleared the ruins and killed Fuel Weaver. Now it's second autumn, and I'm waiting on Berger to spawn so that I can farm some wood and go sailing. While I'm waiting, it's a good time to set up the moonstone with the ring of statues. I'll come back at the start of winter and get my Mooncaller staff. The moment Berger started growling, I backtracked over to the deciduous forest because Berger won't last very long in an evergreen forest. I'm gonna spend a day farming wood. And just a reminder that Berger won't harvest logs from a tree if he walks over them. He has to be swiping, charging, or pounding. So most of the time I'm either positioning him to swipe or running away to extend the length of his charge. After I harvest enough wood, I'm gonna force Berger into a slightly early hibernation. If I can kill him this one time for the sketch, then I can keep him alive forever next time he spawns. As of 1,000 days in this world, I have yet to let Berger die again. And he gets his contractual stack of honey in exchange for the annual autumn services rendered. Now it's time to build the boat and head on out to the Lunar Island, which appears likely to be off the coast of the Triple Mac Tusk biome. I could also wait until I get an astral detector from the archives, but as long as I have time before the next full moon, I might as well get this out of the way now. I also get to set another backstep right at the fissure triangle. This will be super useful once we start moving altar pieces. I'm actually going to use it one time on the island just to move over the altar piece that's the farthest away. A purple gem is a fair price for saving me like 2 to 3 minutes of statue hauling. On the way back, I spotted a message in a bottle which revealed Pearl's Island, which is spitting distance from the Lunar Island. And there's a salt formation and a shoal on the way over. This tiny bit of ocean has given me everything I need from the sea in this run, so thanks to World Gem for doing me a solid. Now I'm gonna start working on Mama Pearl's quests. For the first trip, I'm gonna bring her a breezy vest. It's an easy friendship point in winter to give her any body clothing with insulation while it's snowing. That includes a raincoat, a dapper vest, a puffy vest, literally anything with insulation. While I'm out here, I can also tent the island for lure plant infestation and hang her own kelp on her own drying racks. I get it, you don't wanna strain your back, lady. No, it's fine. I'm sure this other old lady doesn't mind doing it. We can also give her a sour flowlet, and now we're up to 4 friendship points. On the next visit, I'm gonna park 8 berry bushes. It's good that juicy bushes work because we don't have the cute ones. Then we're gonna do all 3 house upgrades, which includes 10 cookie cutter shells I farmed from the nearby salt formation. That brings us up to 8 friendship points. With 4 days left of winter, I could try to catch a heavy ice bream and dredge up her water trash, but instead I'm gonna wait until spring because there are 2 other points that will be a lot easier to get. So in the meantime, let's deconstruct our Mooncaller staff and go to the archives. I can use the iridescent gem to activate the archives, and the blue fountain will poop out the holy brain bulb that I need. Then we can do the canonically relevant puzzle and get the blueprint for the astral detector. That's literally all I want here. Wanda out. In our second spring, I'm able to catch and bury 10 butterflies for Pearl. Then while it's raining, she can have an umbrella. 10 out of 10. Now hand that pearl over before I glitch you onto a boat. Now I'm back on the mainland hunting for the sanctum pieces. I almost always find both pieces in the same biome, so it surprised me when these 2 pieces spawned in completely different biomes. One in the savanna and one in the swamp. I actually didn't mind the extra hunting because it gave me time to reuse a single rift watch to bring both pieces to Lunar Island. But now the sanctum is assembled and all that's left is the tribute. Back on the mainland, I'm planting the astral detector again, and it looks like Crab King is chilling right off the coast of Mosaic. So awesome, I can just head back home and grab my purple gems and gear for the fight. I'm guessing I'll need around 3 ice staves and 2 weather panes, but I'm bringing extra in case Crab King heals. The TAM is important for insulation against freeze damage, but thankfully I don't need any armor here. The strategy is basically the same one I use on most of my Crab King fights, including the one I did as Walter and as Warly. But there are a couple key differences with Wanda in this fight. First, I'm able to back up a lot further after the first freeze. It's a good idea to put as much distance as you can between Crab King and your boat, because it means fewer claws will be able to reach you. This also makes structures on the edge of your boat a lot safer from claws. The last thing you want is a lightning rod destroyed while it's raining. The other key difference is that Old Wanda does so much damage that she can trigger Crab King to start healing right after summoning claws, which I don't really want the first time. So once he summons, I'm waiting a moment to start attacking again. It's not necessary, but in my experience, it's helped me to keep the pattern of the fight a lot more consistent. It didn't work out this time, but next round I'll be able to take out the claws while he does the ice cast. It's so nice being able to melt these ice claws with just 5 hits. I got some skitter squids towards the end of the fight and was super nervous that a weather pain hit would aggro them onto me. Fortunately, they decided that Granny was on the side of the angels, and the moment Crab King froze them, they all started buzzsawing away at him. I don't think they dealt the finishing blow right here, but the extra damage definitely helped. This fight is still very tricky as Wanda, but at least with senior citizen power, it ends a lot faster. Old Wanda is great for this fight because she's not at risk of taking that much damage. So now we can winch up the tribute, sail back to shore, and use a rift watch to deliver the tribute directly to the lunar island. I don't like to open rift watches on boats because they have a tendency to open up onto the ocean, so you miss the window to jump in. Moonstorms fired up on day 123. I'm gonna grab a couple potatoes and moonglass from my base and run straight into the moonstorm. Wagstaff will deliver my blueprints and I can make 2 astroggles right away. Desert goggles work in the moonstorm, but I have no idea how long it will take to fish up the blueprints at the oasis. So for this run, I'm Buzz Lightyear, mutated tuber edition. Beginning of summer, I am running my first moonstorm. This was right before the October Quality of Life update, which fixed a major bug in the targeting system that caused a significant delay in the retargeting of new mobs. This bug is on full display in the Moonstorm, where for a moment your character will stand completely still after smacking a moonbird before moving on to the next one. I made it a habit of moving my character manually after smacking each bird to force the game to acquire a new target faster. But after the Quality of Life, I can just hold down attack and kill all the birds in a flock, one after another. It's almost as significant of an improvement to the experience as the improved spoilage time of both moon gleams and infused moon shards. This whole process is much less painful nowadays. I'm not showcasing the strategy very well in this run, but if you go with astroggles for the event, I recommend switching between 2 occasionally to distribute the durability equally. Getting zapped by a moon gleam will charge all of the astroggles in your inventory, not just the one you're wearing. So you can save on zaps by charging up multiple astroggles at the same time. I'm taking a break to deal with Antlion, one boss that I did not get to in my first year. I actually didn't know if astroggles worked in the sandstorm, but hey, they totally do. That very wonderfully removes the extremely luck-dependent reliance on getting the desert goggles. I can complete this boss run without fishing for days at the oasis, and for that I am very thankful. I saved these astroggles at 1%. That probably would have killed me to get slowed down at that moment. With Wanda, I try to stay close to Antlion when attacking. The range of the clock means you run a bigger risk of targeting sand spikes as Wanda, so if you're relying on the auto-targeting, then it's better to make sure Antlion is closest to you. Still, Wanda should make short work of Antlion, provided she doesn't die first. Thank you for the Lazy Deserter, the most important boss drop of any solo world. For the second moonstorm, I'm planting a lure plant close to where I'll be delivering tools to Wagstaff. This moonstorm is really close to my base, and I don't want any of my stuff burning. So I'm using a lure plant as a sort of wildfire catcher. If one triggers on me, then the lure plant will be the one to smolder, just as an extra precaution. By day 132, I've got 3 restrained static, 15 moon gleams, and 30 infused shards. So I'm gonna jump straight over to the lunar island and fire up the celestial champion fight. For the first couple phases, the lunacy aura isn't super intense, so I can just start the fight with low lunacy, throw on a thulocyte crown, and snack on the occasional sugar boogers. Wanda's whip can reach the boss from outside of its flap range, so no kiting needed for that attack. Just get out of the way for the Gestalt summon. Phase 2 for me is the most dangerous phase for Wanda. I'm going to switch out my knight armor for a magiluminescence, otherwise I won't have enough speed to dodge the blades, and I'm pretty sure that one mistake here would kill me. Be careful during the spike attack, because from whip range, Wanda is far enough away to get hit. So to avoid that, wait until just after it pokes the moon, then run right up to the boss and keep hitting. Another weird thing about phase 2 is that it will skip its little melee attack and go straight back to the Gestalt summons if it doesn't have a target in melee range. So if you want the extra time in the attack cycle, then you'll want to bait the melee attack by running into range for a moment. Beginning of phase 3, I got a Hound Wave. No big deal, I can either just back off and deal with the hounds myself, or let them attack Celestial Champ. I decided to back off and fight them because I didn't trust myself to not get hit by lasers. For phase 3, I'll switch to the Bone Helm because the Sanity Auras are super strong, and it's hard to smash Glomergoop fast enough to keep up with your rising lunacy. I figured out about halfway through that there's actually a sweet spot for Wanda to attack during this phase. Check it out. You run up to the boss and smack it with your whip. Now, nudge one step closer and continue attacking. This will put you close enough so that you'll trigger the boss's melee attack, but Wanda will still be outside of the attack range. So you can safely swing from here and the boss won't fly away or fire lasers. As with many Wanda methods, this too borders on cheese. What redeems it slightly is that you do need to understand exactly where to place Wanda, and if you mess up, you can get a laser to the face. Celestial Champion falls on day 135, and Wanda gets her crown. Now there are two bosses left in the run, and I'll start with the easier one, Malbatross. So day 1 of autumn, I'm sailing back to the shoal near Pearl's Island. It only takes two snags to spawn Malbatross, and now we can start. I'm gonna wear my knight armor for protection and hit Malbatross with a regular spear. I'm also wearing an umbrella because last time I did this, I started freezing from getting wet. It was probably all the waves when she backs off, but either way, I'll start with the knight armor, and if that runs out, I'll switch to a thulasite crown. I need to get better at keeping Malbatross near the edge of the boat. Even when I need to repair the boat, I'll want to position myself so that she doesn't fly to the center, because then I have nowhere on the boat to dodge her attacks. Remember, if you're trying to maximize feather drops, then you can fight her with a low damage weapon and land more hits. Just count on needing more armor and more boat patches, because the fight will last longer. Now Malbatross is dead, and we have one more boss in the run. Misery Toadstool. First, we need a scarecrow to attract a canary, and fortunately, they're in season in autumn. After several days of farming, I finally got a pumpkin from a generic seed. While that's growing, I'm hunting for the toadstool cap in the caves. There it is, right next to the green mushroom forest. So now we just need to finish growing the pumpkin, catch a canary, and poison it in the caves. While I'm waiting on that, Berger respawns. So I'm baiting him around the forest to farm some wood. I actually died to Berger right here because of a weird bug. Basically, when you take two simultaneous hits, if the first hit breaks an armor, then sometimes the second hit will go straight to a player's health before the second armor auto-equips and reduces the damage. You see, I had an extra knight armor in my inventory, but it didn't matter. Hit number 2 is a TKO. This happened to Glurms recently on his hardcore mega base world while fighting Antlion. If you ever hear us say that bugs are the leading killer of long-running worlds, this is what we're talking about. I really hope that this one gets fixed soon. Day 154, I am kicking off the final fight with Misery Toadstool as Old Wanda. For the beginning, I'm gonna lure it out a ways before attacking. My gear for this fight will be a Thulasite crown and a Magiluminescence. It won't be as much protection as knight armor, but that extra speed is really important to me. So I just need to be very careful and try to avoid as much damage as possible. 15 damage might not seem like a lot, but when you're constantly less than 37 damage away from death, it's substantial. My goal each round is to chop down 3 to 4 spore caps with the glass axes before Toad finishes summoning them. This is where the mag speed is really important. Then, I'll put Toad to sleep with the pan flute and chop down the rest. I'll only be able to do this 7 or 8 times, and then Toad will be too resistant to the pan flute. Fortunately, we are already at phase 3 when that happens. So now I'm switching to ice staves to finish chopping the trees. I have a bunch of weather paints, but I'm trying to avoid using them for as long as possible. The more I can chop, the cheaper this fight will cost. Depthworms coming in hot on phase 4. I'm luring them around Toadstool so they'll die to the stomps and the boom shrooms. I'm thankful that they're easily dispatched by the boss, but it still sucks because as soon as I hear those growling sounds, I know that we're basically going to lose an entire round of spore caps just spent dealing with the worms. So it's an added resource cost more than anything else, and one that can't really be avoided. The final little wrench in the gears happened towards the end of the fight when both of my dwarf stars went out. I must have thrown these up way before the start of the fight because I was only like 17 minutes in, and those stars last 28 minutes. The magiluminescence saved my butt right here. Next time, I need to wait until right before the fight to cast the stars. For most boss fights, it won't matter, but this fight is so long that you're likely to run out of light by the end. Misery Toad fell on day 157, marking the end of the boss run. I might do a little extension to this series because since the run, we got the Terraria update, which added two new bosses to the game. But for now, I'll wrap up the series. The next video I will make for this world will be the base tour at 1000 days. Which we actually hit last week on Twitch. I'm excited to show you some builds in progress, and how I expanded my base with Wanda's teleportation in mind. She's really one of the best characters in the game, and unbelievably strong in the endgame. Just don't get to thinking you're ever safe playing as her. If you like to fight bosses as old Wanda, then you are constantly only a few hits away from death. So know what you're doing before losing a world to something stupid like, oh, I don't know, teleporting somewhere without any light. I really hope you enjoyed the series. In the description, I will post the Twitch collection of the full boss fights, and I will also post the complete collection of past broadcasts, so you don't have to miss a single minute of the world. Let me know in the comments what boss strats you like using with Wanda, and seriously, thank you so much for watching. Take care.